Hello, hello, my friends, and welcome back to my channel. My name is Lizzie. A big warm welcome to you all, and it is so autumnal. I feel like every single video for the last forever, I've been like, it's autumn. Autumn is here. But autumn is here, and today I have some autumnal historical recommendations for you. I know a lot of people like to read spooky things in October, and on one level I do, but that's not my go-to genre usually. But what I do love to read in autumn is historical fiction. I don't know why, but something about it, especially like a certain specific kind of historical fiction, feels very autumnal. And so I thought I would recommend you some. Putting together this recommendations list of historical fiction that specifically has autumnal vibes for me really helped me hone down the kind of historical fiction that I think of as being autumnal, and that is anything set from like Dark Ages through to early 17th, maybe a little bit of 18th century in Europe. That's my autumnal vibes historical fiction. So if that's your go-to, then I have good news for you, my friend. I have some recommendations for you. I will also note all of the books on this list are historical fiction, in that historical fiction is their main genre. They're not a subgenre, so there's no historical romance or historical fantasy on this list, just plain and simple historical fiction. So without further ado, let's get to the books. The first book, and I mean this cover is just so beautifully autumnal, and that is The Familiars by Stacey Hall. And this is set in Lancashire following the Pendle Hill witch trials. We will see a few witch trial things on this list. And it follows the wife of a local lord. She's very young, she's in her teen years, and she gets sort of caught up in the story of these women who are trying to not be murdered for being witches, because they're not. It was a really atmospheric read, definitely set the autumnal tone for me when I read this a couple of years ago, and is a really interesting look into that time period. It is quite a sort of slow read, I think. It takes its time, but if you like a slow-paced curling up in front of the fire book, The Familiars is definitely the one. Continuing on with the witch trials theme, the next one is The Merry Begot by Julie Hearn. And again, this cover is gorgeous. I'm gonna be honest, this cover is the reason I picked this book up. It fully, wholly is the reason that I picked this book up. The Merry Begot is very similar to The Familiars in its setting, in that it's the early 17th century. Witch trials are going on left, right and centre, so early Stuart times, and it follows this time someone who is actually accused of witchcraft herself, a girl who is, I think, again, late teens, and her grandmother, I think she lives with her grandmother, who is the local cunning woman, so basically like herbalist, and of course they get accused of witchcraft. This one was a funny one because it read like a middle grade, but it did have slightly older themes. I think it's a bit of an older one and kind of dates from pre our current ideas of middle grade and YA, and sort of bridges the gap between those two. So if you're looking for something that has kind of a middle grade tone but does deal with some darker and heavier issues, not that middle grade doesn't deal with those issues, but more adult issues that you wouldn't necessarily give to a 10-year-old, then this is definitely one to check out. The next one is a witch one as well. This is purely coincidental. This is purely by accident. I didn't mean to put them all in a row. But hey, here we are. The next one is Hamnet by Maggie O'Farrell. This book was so good. Not to give spoilers for my best books of 2021 video that will be coming in a few months' time, but this one is definitely on there. It's just, it's amazing. It's so, so good. It's so good. Again, very autumnal cover. This book follows Agnes, the wife of William Shakespeare. She's referred to Agnes in this book, and in historical documents was referred to sometimes as Anne, sometimes as Agnes. So although historically she's been remembered as Anne, then names are much more interchangeable in those days, you know? So she may have gone by one or the other, so she's called Agnes in this book. And most of the story centres around the time when her son Hamnet died of the plague, and examines the different character dynamics of and the family dynamics surrounding that. It does flash back quite a lot as well to when she and Shakespeare first met, to when they were newlyweds living with his parents, and it moves around a lot in the setting, and the time period does flash back a little bit as well. This one I found really interesting with the witch element, because one of my favourite tropes, I think, in this sort of fiction is where you have women who are accused of being witches. Everyone refers to them as the local witch, but there is a certain element of ambiguity as to whether or not they actually perform magic. Sometimes they think they do, sometimes they think they don't, and I think that's a really interesting trope when that's explored. And that's what we kind of have here, is you could explain everything away. It could be that she is magical, that she is a witch. I personally feel like the witch element gives it that element of the unknown, which people at the time would have had about things like the plague and about things that we now know about, and that it kind of fills in that gap for us of things that we now consider science, people would have considered magic or witchcraft back in the day. And I think having that extra level of magicalism in this book helps us to sympathise and understand how those characters are feeling about it. This book, I mean, it's just so good. It's so good, and it's not what you would expect. No matter what you're expecting, it surprises you. And one of the things I really liked is that Shakespeare is never referred to by name. I feel like when you have a huge historical figure like Shakespeare or someone, then it can become a bit of a name drop and it sort of distracts from the rest of the story. So he was always defined by his relationship with the other characters in the story. So sometimes he was the father, sometimes he was the husband, sometimes he was the son, sometimes he was the Latin tutor that she flirts with. So his relationship to other people is how he's defined, and it kind of creates this human in the middle who we know is called William Shakespeare, but we're never hit with that "this is William Shakespeare" kind of bomb. I cannot recommend this book highly enough. Just go and read Hamnet. It's amazing. We're veering away now. The next few don't have witches in. But the next one does have some fantastical elements, and that is The Binding by Bridget Collins. This book was so good. Again, I absolutely loved this book. So this book is set in kind of a vague Europe, I would guess. And in this setting, then there is a magic called The Binding, where books have the ability to steal someone's memory. So all books have this magic. All books are a piece of someone's memory, and someone goes to a binder, tells them the thing they want to forget, they want gone from their life, and it gets locked into this book. And only by reading or destroying the book can they get that memory back, which is just such a cool idea. It's so good. And the main character becomes an apprentice to a binder and begins to realize that he doesn't have all of his memories. He has had some of his memories bound before, and he doesn't know where they are or what they are or how to even begin getting them back. And does he even want them back if he willingly gave them up in the first place? This book has so many twists and turns, and it's so good. It's one of those books I finished and then immediately went to my friends and was like, you all need to read this book right now. So now I'm telling you that you need to read The Binding right now. The last book for the first part of this video, again, something a bit different, something a bit more nautical, and that is Mutiny on the Bounty by John Boyne. And I embarrassingly didn't realise that this is based on real events until I started reading it. But this is based on the mutiny on the ship HMS Bounty, which was a ship that was travelling round to Australia in the 18th century, I believe, around the time that the British were, you know, really, really hammering down on doing the terrible thing. I think this is John Boyne's first novel. He's most famous for The Boy in Striped Pyjamas, which is actually my least favourite of all of his books. So if you enjoy historical fiction and you have read Boy in Striped Pyjamas and whatever you thought of it, I think his other books are all better. So if you like ships, nautical things, then Mutiny on the Bounty is one to check out. To finish up, I thought we'd go through some books on my TBR that are all historical fiction, which I'm hoping will have some more autumnal vibes. Similarly to the books I've already talked about, they have that same sort of setting of kind of dark ages through to sort of Stuart era. And so the first one is The Silken Rose by Carol McGrath. I picked this one up yesterday, actually. The supermarket by me has a secondhand bookshelf and you just put some money in the box if you see something that catches your eye, and I saw a few things, so now I have a few new books. But I picked this one up and I thought it sounded really interesting. So it's about Eleanor of Provence. It's set in 1236, so 13th century, and Eleanor of Provence was the wife of Henry III. I know very little about Henry III, so I'm intrigued to read more. And she was known as the She-Wolf from Provence. So I think she's going to be a really interesting character to kind of read about, learn about, but also a bit of escapism into her story. The next book is The Lady of the Ravens by Joanna Hickson. And this is a Tudor novel about a girl who is a lady-in-waiting to Elizabeth of York, who was the wife of Henry VII. I think this is again going to be a really interesting one. Obviously, Henry VII was the first of the Tudors. I love the Tudors, as you can tell from my Tudor, there it is, my Tudor shelf. I am at some point going to do a whole video just shaming myself for my Tudor TBR because it's a bit excessive. But yes, so this is, I think, I don't know if she's a real person or not, the main character for this one, but sort of it'll be set around the beginning of the Tudor era, and I'm intrigued to learn about the kind of transition from the Plantagenets to the Tudors. And the last one is another Tudor book, and that is the Six Tudor Queens series by Alison Weir. This is the first book, Catherine of Aragon, the True Queen. I have the first five. I don't think Catherine Parr is out in paperback yet. So I think it's out in hardback, but not in paperback. So I'm keeping an eye out for that one. But I haven't read any of them. I have them and I just haven't read them. So I really want to read this. I really want to get stuck into this series. I really enjoy Alison Weir's writing. And I've read her non-fiction book about the Six Wives of Henry VIII. So I'm really intrigued to see her fiction take, because she, as with in a non-fiction book, you kind of, you know, you get the author's opinions about the people they're writing about. And I'm intrigued to see how much of those opinions carry over into her fictionalised versions of their lives. She definitely has her favourites of the Six Wives. So I'm intrigued to see how she treats them all in fiction. And especially, I think, also knowing what she knows, if that makes sense. You know, she's been in her non-fiction books, is she's quite upfront about the fact that we don't know much about anyone past the first couple of wives. We know so much about Catherine of Aragon and Anne Boleyn, but not so much about the other wives. So I'm intrigued to see where she takes the series, what she kind of brings to it as well. So there we go. We have some autumnal historical fiction recommendations. What sort of thing do you enjoy to read in autumn? Do you like reading historical fiction in autumn? If you have any recommendations for me, I would love to know them. So please let me know down in the comments. Thank you very much for watching. All of my social medias are in the description, as is a list of all of the books that I talked about in this video. I will see you next time. Bye!